Hello, brothers and sisters. Did that sound pastoral? Not? Okay, whatever. This is our online service for April 18, 2021, and we welcome you here. We're glad to have you tuning into New Hope, however you do it. This week, we do have in-person worship on the New Hope grounds in the building at 10 a.m. Worship only. It will be the same next week. And we also will have online worship like we've got right here, not only for the next 2 weeks, but for the foreseeable future. So you can always tune in online if you want. On May 4th, we do a bit of a change at New Hope. We're going to add Sunday school to the picture as we begin to ramp things up and get to a fully active summer, we hope, or at least by the fall. But we're going to add Sunday school on the first Sunday in May, 2 or 4, can't remember which it is, but that first Sunday in May. And here's, it will be, the schedule will be 10 o'clock adult worship as we have been doing. And coinciding with that will be junior worship for the kids. And then Sunday school will be at 11 o'clock and we will have classes for all ages of people. So if you're interested, please come out, be a part of that. For details of how that comes together, stay tuned on our, through our email chain. And if you're not on that and you want to be on the email prayer chain and news chain, then just send me a note requesting that. My email address is j.sichting, S-I-C-H-T-I-N-G, at mac.com. Just send me a note from your email address letting me know you want to be on the list, and I will add you to it. I should also mention this at the end of April, Beth will be then full-time at New Life Church in Nashville. She's been at New Hope for 20 years. We'll miss her. So make sure to say a big thank you to Beth Johnson before she gets out of town, and to Greg too. He's done a lot of things here at New Hope that we really appreciate. And they'll still be part of us in different ways too. So they're not gonna disappear completely. Also, just know that Sarah Hudson is going to be the interim children's program director all the way through the summer at the very least. And if I'm doing this right, there will be a picture of Sarah here. And just what you can do about that is just keep her in your prayers as she goes about it. She's prayed it up and is excited about it and is a little bit nervous. So make her feel at home and give her some encouragement as she tries to do that work. The other thing that I will mention to you is for 7th through 12th graders, Eli has scheduled a skate night on April 22nd from 6 to 8 p.m. The cost for that is $5. It's at Columbus Skateland. And guess what? It's a Hawaiian-themed skate night. So put on your best Hawaiian outfit. I know you're going to have some trouble deciding between all your Hawaiian outfits, but pick out your best Hawaiian outfit and join the youth group as they have fun on that night. They're going to be joined by another youth group or two. Sounds like a good time, and sounds like an opportunity for some bruises too. Hope you find our online service today a worshipful experience. I got sort of fascinated last week with the story of the scars on Jesus, and I think that's interesting in several different kind of ways. And we touched on it in the sermon last week, but I want to talk about it again today. The sermon today is Wounds, Part 2, and guess what? There will even be a Wounds, Part 3, I anticipate, next week. So who knew that the scars would turn into a three-part sermon series? I hope you enjoy. Send us a note sometime to that same email address, j.seichting, S-I-C-H-T-I-N-G, @mac.com, and let me know where you're worshiping from. That would be kind of interesting. That's all. Enjoy.
Answer me when I call to you, O God, who declares me innocent. Free me from my troubles. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people ruin my reputation? How long will you make groundless accusations? How long will you continue your lies? You can be sure of this. The Lord set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will answer when I call to him. Don't sin by letting anger control you. Think about it overnight and remain silent. Offer sacrifices in the right spirit and trust the Lord. Many people say, "Who will show us better times?" Let your face smile on us, Lord. You have given me greater joy than those who have abundant harvests of grain and new wine. In peace, I will lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, will keep me safe.
Yeah. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be the children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Dear friends, now we are the children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. All who have hope in Him purify themselves, just as He is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that He appeared so that He might take away our sins. And in Him is no sin. No one who lives in Him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen Him or known Him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as He is righteous.
Well, the title of this sermon is Wounds, Part 2. And spoiler alert, don't be surprised if next week there is a Wounds, Part 3. Let's not move too quickly from Easter. Last week, we read the account from John's Gospel that reports Jesus' appearance to His disciples in that closed room on the evening of the resurrection. And today, we read a similar account from Luke in chapter 24, beginning with verse 36, where suddenly Jesus Himself stood among them, His followers who are gathered in Jerusalem, and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. And he told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." There are some differences here from John's story, notably Jesus' inquiry about something to eat and then him eating a piece of fish in their presence, which indicated just how embodied Jesus was in the resurrection, as if to say, "Look, I'm obviously not a ghost. Ghosts don't eat." But another feature of the embodiment of Jesus emphasized in Luke's story is also in John's. And that is the visible wounds of the crucifixion on his body. "Look at my hands and my feet," Jesus says. "It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." Last week, we spent some time talking about those wounds. Isn't it a bit surprising that the resurrected Christ still carries the scars of his earthly life? I mean, we usually advertise resurrection as an occasion for new bodies, perfect and without blemish. We will all be Michael Jordan in eternity. We will all look like Brad Pitt or Jessica Alba, or insert your preference there. But who knows? That is yet to be seen. And I wouldn't begin to know how to prophesy about that. Is there healing in eternal life? So, for instance, did Jesus' resurrected body on earth carry the scars that were then gone with his ascension into heaven? Or do they remain, as might seem to be indicated in that scene in Revelation 5, where John peers into eternity to see Jesus looking as a lamb that had been slain? And then what of those scars that we've earned in this life? Are they healed and removed? Or do they mean too much to disappear? Is it rather that our way of viewing scars is what changes in new creation? Don't know. But scars can be beautiful, can be meaningful at least. All through her childhood, our daughter Nicole bore a scar right in the middle of her forehead, the result of falling into the corner of a pew one Sunday night at church, that Mark was a reminder of a very eventful night when people from our church in Greene County, Indiana, helped us get through an awful snowstorm and to the emergency room in Bloomington, where a doctor from my alma mater, Milligan University, put the stitches in her head. And for many years after that, Chris and I made that mark right in the middle of her forehead, the target place for our goodnight kisses. Some marks mean something. When I played baseball and then softball, one of the things that used to happen in the dugout was that players would compare injuries. Jammed fingers, bruises from getting hit by pitch. For a couple of decades of my life, every summer, whole summer long, I'd be nursing a strawberry on my left leg from sliding into base. And it was something to brag about. Oh yeah, you think you got a good one? Just check out this oozing beauty that I've got right here. It was a mark of dedication. It was a battle wound proudly worn. And then, of course, some bear wounds of literal war. Scars from shrapnel and bullets, lost eyes and limbs, hidden scars, too, that are invisible to the eye, but nevertheless etched into bodies. Certainly those wounds say something. It may be hard for us to imagine ourselves apart from our scars. I wouldn't be sure it was really me if I didn't see this scar on my hand that I got clowning around in college with a glass jar in my hand and then fell right on top of it. Or the scar on a finger on the same hand from using a knife inappropriately. Or the mark on my abdomen where doctors took out an infected and leaking appendix. Or the scar on my back from the discectomy that gave me pain-free living again. In a weird way, I have sort of grown fond of those scars. Some of my story is told by those scars. None of this answers any theological questions, of course, but it does help me to understand why it might be important for Jesus to show up complete with the wounds of crucifixion. They are part of his story. Battle wounds in the most important war that ever was, the war with death. And in resurrection, these wounds acquire a kind of beauty. As I said last week, in much the same way that the resurrection transforms the cross, an instrument of cruel execution, converts it into a sign of hope. So why does Jesus show up, wounds and all? Here's one of the things that I think those wounds suggest. That just as God featured the wounds of Jesus in our Lord's continuing story, so too God can and will take the scars of our life and turn them into something meaningful. We're all wounded people, right? Even if the surface of your body is in good shape and hasn't yet been roughed up by accident, disease, or surgery, you've got scars. If nowhere else, then inside. some of them that, as with Jesus, have come from the outside world. Pain that you didn't really deserve. Unfairness. Abuse. All those times that the world did a number on you. We all bear injury externally inflicted. But unlike Jesus, we also carry with us self-inflicted wounds. Shameful episodes in our lives, bad choices we've made, things we've said that we can't take back. We've all done things that we wish had never happened, but guess what? They did. And the thing about time is there's no going back. The past can't be undone. And the thing about memory is what we would like to be forgotten isn't. We carry our marks. Our marks follow us in life. But what if these resurrection appearances of Christ still bearing wounds, what if that is also good news about how God handles us? Christ continues to carry the wounds of crucifixion, but now those marks, which were at first signs of defeat, those marks have in the resurrection been shown as part of the victory. How far the victory has gone. God has conquered this. What the church proclaims is Christ crucified and raised from the dead. And the joy of the raised from the dead part only fully makes sense when it comes out of the horror of the crucified and buried part. The wounded and killed body of Jesus now stands before the disciples alive. God took the shattered hope of crucifixion day and put the pieces together again, not as though those terrible events had never happened, but as a demonstration of what all has been overcome. The wounds remind us how hope had gone to pieces, but God's put it all back together. Makoto Fujimura is an American artist of Japanese descent who paints abstract expressionist works of art. If I remember when I start putting this video together, there will be some of his works flashing right now. He uses some very ancient techniques to make his own pigments by stone grinding minerals like gold, azurite, and malachite to make his own paint, and then to build up these very layered canvases. He's also a convert to Christianity and a very insightful theologian. He recently published a book called Art and Faith that I use for my class at Emmanuel in March. One of the things that he talks about in that book is an art form that might be helpful for understanding all we're talking about today. And that art form is called kintsugi. Kintsugi means golden joinery, and is the ancient Asian art of taking broken pieces of pottery and mending them together with a glue mixed with powdered gold and silver or platinum or other precious metals. The kintsugi artist doesn't try to hide the breaks in the pottery as though nothing ever happened, but it instead accentuates the fractures and honors the imperfections that history has placed on the object. the end result is not a repaired piece of pottery with no visible cracks, but something with newness, as he puts it in his book, something that still retains the basic form of the past, but which is now better. And I should mention that if you ever have the option of receiving an old teacup or a kintsugi cup, always take the kintsugi cup, because it will be the one that's more valuable by far, the broken one that has been put together by an artist. When Jesus came back to his disciples, the cracks are still in view. And at least for that time, I'll leave it up to you to theologize about where things go from there. But at least the beginning, Jesus shows up with the marks. The cracks are there, and they're not just there, they are prominently in view. Not disguised as if it's an embarrassment, but rather highlighted. Jesus says, look here. See the marks. See the disfigurement. But what had before meant defeat now shows the extent of victory. God has been victorious even over this. And as I say, I think that is the story of the rest of us. Even those of us who've added scars to ourselves. It's not so much that God makes them go away, although he can, I suppose, if that's what God chooses. But at least most often, it seems to me, he helps our stories move forward despite the breaks and the wounds in our lives. In fact, the Apostle Paul seems to suggest in 2 Corinthians 5 that it is through his weakness, his brokenness, that God displays power. Not in spite of weakness, but through it. And what's Paul's story? The Apostle Paul had this legacy of tormenting the church, and that remembrance of torment would always be part of his story. But after an experience with the risen Christ, his former life was just shattered into pieces so that God could put him all together in a more meaningful way. All those pieces of the past still remained a part of him, but they are reassembled into a testimony to God's power. King David, despite horrible sin in his life that left a mark on himself and others, got put together enough by God in order to do important things. The fact that Peter denied Jesus never goes away. It is still a part of Christian memory. 2,000 years, and Peter's denial of Jesus hasn't been forgotten. And yet, despite that, God put him back together so that he would be a prominent missionary and leader in the early church. And isn't that the real hope of redemption? That all our confusing brokenness will be brought together by our God, who seems to know a thing or two about kintsugi, and can bring out of broken, scattered pieces a work of art. I can't help but mention Jacob Jones every now and then, first of all, because he's so close to my heart, but also because I think he is a fine example of how God redeems people. We're all broken and addicted to things. It's just that his problems were very public and were visible to all of us. An alcoholic who through the years had squandered relationships and health. It was finally in great brokenness, completely in pieces, that he cried out to God. He wanted the pieces of his life brought back together. And God honored his cry. Slowly, painfully, in stops and starts, God began reforming him, bringing all the fragments back together. And what's interesting about that is that nothing in his history changed. What had happened was still a part of who he was. But God glued the pieces together to make him whole. Still the cracks, but they are now filled with gold. And the new vessel is, I have to think, the best version of him that ever was. Better than before the pieces started to come apart because a wonderful artist got a hold of him and put him back together in a new way. And as I emphasize, Jacob's story is only unique in the kind of story that it is, a story that had a very public aspect to it and a very sharp then and now contrast. But it is actually the story of anyone who is in Christ. We were broken. We were all broken. And God took the pieces and made a legitimate piece of art out of us. Actually, it's not usually gold glue that God works with. He often works with water.
He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. He was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice in the life that you gave. We are healed for you paid the price by your grace. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We are healed by your sacrifice in the life. For you paid the price.
Mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Those are the rather gut-wrenching words of David after he sinned with Bathsheba, the prayer that's recorded in Psalm 51. I probably sound like a broken record because I mention this a lot, but when we come to the Lord's table, there are so many things going on. There's sacrifice. There is the celebration of community. There is the looking forward. There's eschatology, the looking forward to the world that is to come. There is fellowship with Jesus. There is all these things. But among these, there is also confession. We shouldn't come to the table without opening our hearts up to the Lord. And our hearts are cracked open to him. It's whether we want to acknowledge it or not. And so I always think it is appropriate when we come to the table to also treat it as a time of confession. And my favorite prayer of confession is one that I would like for you to recite with me. It's the basic prayer of confession that's in the Book of Common Prayer. This is the modern version. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.